Good morning.
Good morning. Welcome you all to our divine service for this second Sunday of the Pentecost season as we rejoice in all the gifts of Christ that come to us through His Spirit and Word. For those of you joining us online, if you want to get a copy of the bulletin to follow along, we are on our webpage, www.mountcalvarypeoria.org, and you'll see in the menu where you can download a copy of this to follow along. For the rest of you all, we invite you to fill out the registration cards and drop off the offering plate in your heart. And with that said, we're still casting the peace safely, so everyone's safely away from one another across the peace. And we recognize that here in the United States, today is being honored as Father's Day, and as is our custom, we like to say a prayer of forefathers. So I invite you to stand for prayer. Gracious and loving God, you provide for all your children in ways so wonderful that they understand or even see. You give us food, shelter, clothes and work, friends and family, sun and rain, spring and fall, and more than we can reckon. You also give us our fathers, men in whom we have come to know something of your love that protects us, guides us, provides for us, and seeks for us to strive after the best. Lord, we thank you for our fathers, and we pray that you would help us to honor them for your sake, to love them and support them in their work, to serve and obey them that they may be cheered through us. We pray also that you would be with our fathers and all fathers, that you would aid them with your spirit and comfort, that you would strengthen them in your love and guide them in your wisdom, and that through your Son you would make them witnesses to your love in this world. Finally, Lord God, we ask that you comfort both those whose fathers have died and those fathers who carry the burden of having their children. Let your gentle spirit give them the peace of knowing that in you nothing is truly lost, and that in your Son we continue to walk in union by faith with those who have gone to the rest before us. We pray these things, trusting in your abundant grace through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. And you may be seated. Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We say we have no sin to deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
Most gracious God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unworthy. We have sinned against you, your thought, word, and deed, by our what we have done, and by our what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your presence and your punishment.
And we are picking up Jesus' public ministry. We're going to be reading a lot from Luke 8 throughout the rest of the summer, the rest of Luke. But today, Jesus is going to encounter a guy who is possessed by a demon, which is pretty awful stuff because demons are really nasty and they're unclean. And this demon was making him live amongst tombs where dead people are buried, and he was by a bunch of pigs and their unclean animals, and it was just a miserable thing. But Jesus comes to him, and the Lord tells that demon, you go away and leave this guy alone. Even though the man would have been considered ritually unclean and icky and awful and probably a Gentile as well, Jesus didn't care. He still came to him and sent that demon away. Now, the demon thought he was going to pull a big trick against Jesus. The demon said, oh, Jesus, don't be mean to me. Don't send me down to the abyss. Let me go into those pigs. Now, do you think Jesus knew the trick that the demon was going to try and pull? All right, the Lord knows everything, right? He wasn't fooled, but what do you think Jesus cared about? A bunch of pigs or that guy who was possessed? He cared about more of the possessed guy. And so he let the demons go into those pigs, and the demons said, aha, we'll cause trouble. They caused the pigs to go off a cliff into the lake and all drowned. And how do you think the owners of the pigs thought about that? Well, they lost 2,000 head of pig. Did they like that? Not at all. They were kind of frightened and they were kind of angry with Jesus. But that man, after Jesus did this, he was in his right mind again. He was able to wear clothes like a normal person. And the first thing he did was sit at Jesus' feet so he could start hearing the Lord and listening to him. And so the people come out from the town and they see the guy and he's normal and he's dressed and he's listening to Jesus. And then there are all the pigs walking around in the lake dead. And the people like go, Jesus, you know what? I don't think we want you around here. You go away. Can you imagine asking Jesus to go away? No, that's awful, right? And, you know, sometimes for us, when we try to do a favor for someone and they treat us bad in return, do we like those people very much? No, we're like, okay, I'm not going to help you anymore, right? But that's not how Jesus acted. Jesus said, I'm not going to argue with you, go away. But that man who had been possessed, Jesus said, I need you to stay behind. I want you to go around and tell your friends and your family all the great things that God has done for you. And so that man went and he told all the things that Jesus did for him. And a little more than a year later, Jesus is back in that area. And the people don't ask him to leave this time. Instead, they bring someone to him for Jesus to help because that man's witness was able to change their hearts and their minds. And that's the same thing true for us, right? When God sends us out, whether we're with our families at home or at school or out in recreation, God gives us an opportunity to share his grace, to speak about the great things that Jesus has done so that hearts and minds can be brought to him. So as you hear that gospel lesson, think about all that stuff that we just talked about and remember that Jesus tells you, go home and tell everyone the great things that God has done for you. Amen.
Thank you.
the lifter of my head.
Asked him to depart from them, but they were seized with great fear.
means had gone and begged that he might be with him. But Jesus sent him away, saying, return to your home and declare how much God has done for you. And he went away, proclaiming throughout the whole city how much Jesus had done for him. This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ.
That man's condition is he
first meets Jesus. Obviously, he's possessed, and that's an awful thing all of its own. But also look at the details that surround this. He lived among the tombs. Now, in the Old Testament, tombs and dead bodies were considered ritually unclean. They defiled a person so that he or she could not draw near to the Holy God. And the place was not only amongst tombs, but it was near a hillside that pigs would graze on. And then this demon that possessed him is described by Luke as an unclean spirit. In other words, this was, man was about as unclean or defiled as you could get. There was no way that he could safely draw near to a holy God to receive life or light. And yet what happened? Jesus, God in the flesh, drew near to him. I brought this out because there's something here for us. One of the things that we don't always talk about are the sins that make us unclean. Defiled. And I'm not talking about something like, you know, I don't even banging your shin into a drawer or something like that. There are sins that we fall into that we know we've messed up and we repent and we receive forgiveness and we move on and that's life. But there are other sins that stain us and leave us feeling guilty, ashamed, and yes, unclean. And this, by the way, is one of the reasons that Paul is so adamant about turning converts away from sexual sins. For he understood that what we do with the body or what is done to us in the body, that has very deep consequences. No matter how our culture tries or how the ancient world tried to reduce bodily things to just a casual affair, there's nothing casual about what happens with our bodies. And so there are sins that leave us shame, feeling unclean. And this also can be a matter of, you know, if you've ever broken a confidence or if you violated someone's trust, or maybe you were dishonest. I've known folks who feel rotten about themselves, undeserving of love and grace because of things that they did to cheat, to harm others. The point here is simply that we all know of things that we've done or that we've said or that we've thought that left us ashamed and feeling unworthy, cut off from God. And the devil loves to exploit that. If you try to go to church, he'll say, oh, you're just being a hypocrite. Or he'll try to convince you that everyone knows what you've been doing. They're all looking at you. They're all watching you. They're all judging you. Folks who have sins that make them feel defiled often just avoid the church because it is too uncomfortable. And yet, Jesus still comes to us in our flesh. He heals. There is no sin so awful, nothing so unclean or defiling that can keep Jesus away from you. You may not feel worthy to come to him, but he comes to you just as he came to that man possessed by that unclean spirit. He comes to you to heal and cleanse you. Remember, he knows all about you already. There are no secrets with him, and he pays no mind in where you are, amongst tombs, by curtain page, whatever. He comes to you to free you from sin, from uncleanness, from guilt and shame. He comes to you with life and love. So rejoice. Anyway, this man was as defiled as he could be, and likely Gentile too, and Jesus came to him anyway to heal him and free him. And then what? Well, when the people of the city came out to see what had happened, they found that man sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. Here is conversion and rebirth in a nutshell. Here is what happened to each one of you, to each of us, when we were brought to faith and to life in Jesus. We have been deranged and defiled in sin and our inheritance from Adam, but now we are brought to the feet of Jesus. Sitting at Jesus' feet is the customary place of a disciple, ready to hear, to listen, to learn, to receive from Jesus. So first, that man simply delights to sit with Jesus, to hear him, to learn. And so too for us. The first and lasting aspect of our discipleship is not found in all the great things that we go out to do. It is found in how we listen and learn. We are all called to sit at Jesus' feet and receive. And then notice that this man is also now clothed. Ever since the fall, nakedness has been a source of shame. We are exposed, defenseless, embarraced. Demons had caused that man to strip off his clothes. They exposed him to shame. But Jesus covers him, gives him back his dignity. Likely there was an extra tunic in the boat. We don't need to worry about where it came from as much as we need to marvel at the grace of Jesus clothing that man. And indeed, Christ clothes us. He gives us our dignity. He covers our shame with himself. Remember Paul writing to the Galatians, all of you who are baptized into Christ His glory is our own. And so to Him, we are given dignity and a place in God's household. We are covered over by Christ. We don't need to hide from others or feel ashamed in their presence. For we have the One who loves us with us. And the man was not simply clothed and at Jesus' feet. He was also in his right mind. Now sin and demons, they had deranged the man. He couldn't think correctly. He couldn't understand or make himself understood. He was driven by the demons, unable to control himself. And again, we get that. If you've ever been caught up in a habitual sin or maybe caught in an addiction, notice how disordered your thoughts become. Rather than using our minds to understand or serve or carry out our very duties, our thoughts get stuck on how to hide sin or how to pursue a sin or how to get a hold of whatever it is that we're addicted to. Our attention is lost, our ability to concentrate undone. But in Christ, freed from sin, we are not just given new hearts, our minds are transformed as well. We are in our right minds. We can concentrate and listen and apply ourselves to our very callings. To the Philippians, Paul recommended being mindful or thinking about those things that are worthy of praise, that are lovely, of good reputation, that are true, noble, pure, virtuous, just. This is what it is to be in one's right mind. It is to employ thought and reason and understanding and direct it toward what is wholesome and good. In Christ, you have your right minds. In fact, St. Paul tells the Philippians to have the same mind in them which was also in Christ Jesus. And you can't get more right-minded than that. So what a transformation that man underwent from the moment he met Jesus to the time those people came out from the city. And that is our transformation in Christ. And again, this is something for joy. Now finally, as Jesus got in the boat to leave the area, the man begged to go with Jesus. But Jesus sent him away. Return. Declare what God has done for you. Here is grace in action. Jesus' grace. And that healed man is a means for that grace to touch others. You may have noticed that the people of the region were unnerved by Jesus, whether they were frightened and angry about losing 2,000 head of pigs or simply frightened by someone who had the power to control demons, demons that they had not been able to deal with on their own. They asked Jesus to leave, and Jesus didn't argue with them. Got back in the boat. Can you imagine? A people so hard-headed, so dense, that they asked Jesus to go away right after he had done a great work for them. In a way, they were echoing what that demon had first said to Jesus at the beginning. The Greek of the demon's question literally reads, "What things that are of concern to me are of a concern to you, Son of God? What business is this of yours?" he asked. "You don't belong here, Jesus. Move along." Now you and me, as I explained to the young ones over there, you and me, if we do strangers a favor and they get all rude with us, we're apt to say, "Fine, whatever, I'm not going to help you with it." If those people didn't want Jesus, we would not have been surprised for them to say, "Okay, whatever. No gospel for you." But he didn't do that. For he's come to save all, grateful or ungrateful, rude or polite, fearful or brave. And so in grace, he leaves the man behind as a witness. Tell him to go. Tell. And indeed, that man proclaimed to all how much Jesus did for him. Back, as I said, a year or so later, when Jesus is back in the region, people didn't ask him to leave, but instead they brought a deaf mute to him for Jesus to heal. The witness had its effect. And just as that man healed of the demons, clothed him in his right mind, became a vehicle of Jesus' grace, so too for you, for all of us. We are clothed with Christ. We have the mind of Christ, and we are given to be witnesses. We can declare what God, what Jesus has done for us. And more than that, we can share his love, his grace, his mercy, and his kindness, whether we're at home, or the workplace, or at our recreations, wherever we go, according to our very lives, we are given to be vehicles of grace, of Christ's grace. For you are healed. So my friends, go and show and declare so. Amen. And now may that peace that surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus until the glorious day of his appearing. Amen. I'd like you to stand to confess our faith in the words of the Christian. I believe in one God,
Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, and all things indivisible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ,
fear
God, fear God, fear God. You God to not be,
being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary,
and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate.
He suffered
and was buried,
and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Lord and the Giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge both my baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen.
And you may be seated. It is my pleasure now to invite for those who have been elected to the offices at Mount Calvary, or who are continuing on in their election to the office, Mr. Ford, the Christ of Installation. Beloved of the Lord, Holy Scripture admonishes us that all things should be done decently and in order. To that end, the Constitution and bylaws of this congregation establish various offices which men and women are elected or appointed to serve. The Apostle Peter writes in his first epistle, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's very grace. Whoever speaks, as one who speaks oracles of God. Whoever serves, as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. These men and women have been elected or appointed and are continuing in office or beginning new offices in this congregation and serving us in various ways at Mount Calvary Evangelical Lutheran Church. You all know that you have been chosen to do specific offices or positions of responsibility in this church. Your work as pastor, that our life together in Christ may be orderly and pleasing in His sight. According to your varied positions, you are to see that the services of God's house are held at proper times, that the Word of God is purely preached and taught according to Lutheran confessions, that the sacraments of Christ are administered according to His institution, that provision is made for the Christian instruction of the young and old, that the erring are admonished, and that discipline is maintained. You are to see that the temporal affairs of this congregation are properly administered, and that proper support is provided for the workers of this congregation. You are to assist in caring for the sick, in cultivating harmony among the members, in promoting the general welfare of the congregation, and furthering the kingdom of Christ here and throughout the world. While holiness of life and obedience to Christ are expected of all members of the congregation, it is especially important that you, as office bearers in this church, show yourself by word and example to be faithful in service of the Christian devotion. So in the presence of God and this congregation, I therefore ask you, do you desire to continue in or accept the offices that are entrusted to you? And do you promise to faithfully carry out your duties, trusting in the Lord and conforming yourself to His word according to the faith of the Evangelical Lutheran Church? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
For you in the congregation, beloved of the Lord, you have heard the promises of faithfulness spoken by these men and women that you have selected to serve Mount Calvary Evangelical Lutheran Church. Do you promise to support them in your work, to remember them with your prayers, and to work with them to the best of the abilities that God has given you, so that He may be glorified and His work be done in our midst? If so, then answer, we do.
We do.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, I install or confirm you in your varied offices at Mount Calvary Evangelical Lutheran Church, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. May Almighty, most merciful God, enlighten and strengthen you in your offices, that you may be good and faithful stewards, for the glory of His name, and for the good of His people. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we give thanks that you raised up these servants for work among your people. We humbly implore you to grant them by your Holy Spirit those gifts needed for the faithful carrying out of your tasks, most especially wisdom, strength, and will to Christ. Let your blessing rest on the congregation. Strengthen the faith, the love, and kindle the zeal of all its members, that your name may be glorified, and that here and in all places under heaven, the kingdom of your Son may be advanced. And then remember with thanksgiving those who faithfully serve your people, and now at the beginning of their time of service, we pray that in the end of days, we meet with all your faithful people, may hear the voice of Christ saying, come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
And now, I bid you all go in the name of the Lord. Be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. The Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve you. You may return to your place. The rest of the congregation is invited to stand for the prayers. And now let us pray for the people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty and eternal God, worthy to be held in reverence by all men. We give you humble hearted thanks for the innumerable blessings, which without any merit or worthiness on our part, you bestow upon us. We pray to you especially that you would preserve for us your saving Lord and the holy sacraments. And we implore you, O Lord, to grant and preserve to your holy church throughout the world purity of doctrine and faithful pastors and teaching word of power. Help all who hear the word rightly understand and truly believe it. Send laborers into your hearts to open the door of faith for those who do not know you. In mercy, remember the enemies of your church and grant them repentance of the line. Protect and defend your church in all tribulation and danger. Strengthen us and all fellow Christians to set our hope fully on the grace revealed in Christ and help us to fight the good fight of faith, that in the end we may receive the salvation of our souls. O Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bestow your grace on all nations of the earth, bless especially our country and its inhabitants and all who are in authority. Let your glory dwell in our land, that mercy and righteousness and peace may abound everywhere. We commend to you the care of all our schools and ask you to grant that our children may grow in useful knowledge and Christian virtue and bring forth wholesome fruits of life. O Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Graciously defend us from all calamity by fire and water, from war and disease, from scarcity and famine, from every other evil. Protect and prosper everyone in her or his right for calling. Let all useful arts flourish among us. Be the God and Father of the widow and the orphan, the helper of the sick and the needy, and the comforter of the forsaken and the distressed. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Accept and implore you our bodies and souls, our hearts and minds, our talents and powers, together with the offerings that we lay before you for your praise and service. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And hear us as we bring our concerns to you in our hearts. Success and speed their healing. Continue to give Mr. Thompson strength and healing. Grant strength to Joel Lionel, Lindsay Meyer, and enforce strength to Adam Weiss, Bill Barr, and Coach, Dan Howell, Katie Payton, Lisa Harrison, Brian Ackford, David Becker, Scott Kingsley, Esther Mark Matthews, Tina Maxwell, Patty McCoy. Grant health and healing to Hugh, Ken Dyer, Deb Wilson, Kate Tagg, Jessica Foreman, Linda Perone, Dave Hine, Jim Camacho, Anne Barr, Earl Boyette, Jackie Darvis, and Mary Dallas. You'll continue healing to Miguel Bolton, Joe Ross, Mandy Carpenter, Richard Colton, Melody Lamb, Carol Hoffman, Jim Casper, Carol Lockridge, Joy Wesley, Penny Boss, Mr. Gary Ruffin, and Natalie Police. Give relief to Mark Kennedy, give healing to Harry Coyle, Brian Kelly, Michael Wilson, Virginia David, Shirley, and Jesus Julie, grant recovery to Mark, grant health and strength to Harry Moore, Bob Kissinger, Sally Taylor, and Mark Rivers, Custom Valley, Chris Patty, Jim, and Gary. Continue to heal Give health to the ones, Jim, you and all travelers through from St. George, also watch over Shirley, Max, Miracle, Neil, Shane, Faith, Genesee, Aaron, Gloria, Sandra, and Phyllis. Give grace and healing to Christiane, Ruth, and Phyllis. Be with Luann, Chubby, Cooper, Yaz, Nicole, Rick, and Carol, and Paula. Give healing to Gary, Smith, and Sharon, Captain, be with Diane Norris, Honey, Porterfield, Scott Wilson, Leah, Victoria, Travis, Pastor Drew, Valerie Connor, Teresa Carrick, Ted Oliver, Marshall, Delcy Lane, Becky Richards, Dave, Mark Dickman, Olivia Bradley, Sharon Rumble, Sherry Ember, Sandra, Larry, Rod, Jane, David, Shannon, Ward, Michael Dale, Kathy Ford, Maureen, Pastor Nina, Mary, Ethan, and Neil, Jonathan, and Long Blue, and Strength, Corey, and Rula. Support for all those recovering from disasters and various sort of things that are working in their need, and every place where they are needed. We pray that you bring peace and justice to the nation. Scourge, war, far off. Stay the hand of the aggressor and comfort and guard and give us and bring the end of the conflict and Russia and Ukraine. Do not let it spread. We pray for those suffering from the coronavirus, asking to grant healing and relief and peace to spread. Give your grace and strength to all medical workers, including responders. Heal the divisions that bring bitterness to our nation, especially before your grace to bring an end to all ethnic and racial hatred and grant understanding, grace, and equity to all. We lift up all of such a violent attack this last week, especially the victims of recent shooting, praying that you grant mercy, healing, faith, and justice, O Lord, for this peace. Watch over Pastor Hayden and his family, bless their service, bless the ministry, according to school, you all students and educators everywhere, keep them in health. Give grace and support to all of our institutions, be with our Senate, all its officers, managers, and honorable presidents, Mark, our district president, and all Senate and district officials, that they may be guided by your word and do those things that are pleasing in your sight. Grant stability, faith, and hope to those who are struggling in this economy. Bless the people of Haiti as they serve and recover and establish a stable civil life. Grant shelter and protection to all refugees, especially those displaced by the conflict in Syria. And finally, we ask that you send your spirit of peace to Somalia, Myanmar, Venezuela, Afghanistan, Europe, Japan, Nigeria, Burkina Faso, the Nagorno Karabakh, the Middle East, especially Israel, Gaza, Iraq, Egypt, Syria, and Yemen, and all places from a war or civil strife. O Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We also ask that while our nation continues to live in peril, while many remain in harm's way, that you watch over us and show mercy to all who are in danger or who suffer, and lay comfort those who mourn, heal those who are injured, and wisdom and humility to those who mourn. Continue to be with Derek Foote, Joshua Foote, Alex, Elizabeth Howard, Zeke, Harrison, and all employed in active duty and over their personnel and their families. Be the shield and protector of the innocent. Protect all those disabilities everywhere, bringing wicked injustice. Defend the righteous and lead all of our many voices to peace. We know that all things are in our hands, Father. We ask that you would bring justice, establish our government according to your will. O Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And as we are strangers and pilgrims on earth, help us by true faith and a godly life to prepare for the world to come, doing the work that you have given us to do all this day, for the night comes when no one can work. And when our last hour comes, support us by your power, since the year 15. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you, the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We continue the offer.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Take a drink, let Christ shape you. Take a drink, let Christ shape you. Take a drink, let Christ shape you.
Thank you.
May the true body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his most precious blood strengthen you in true faith, granting you forgiveness of sins and the life of lost. Depart in peace.
Amen.
We join you in the peace. With that said, the service is ended. Go in peace.